Annabel was, like the writer, of mixed parentage, half English, half Dutch in her case. I remember her features far less distinctly today than I did a few years ago, before I knew Lolita. There are two kinds of visual memory. One, when you skillfully recreate an image in the laboratory of your mind, with your eyes open, and I see Annabel in such general terms as honey-colored skin, thin arms, brown bobbed hair, long lashes, big bright mouth. And the other, when you instantly evoke with shut eyes on the dark inner side of your eyelids the objective, absolutely optical replica of a beloved face, a little ghost in natural colors. And that is how I see Lolita. Let me therefore primarily limit myself in describing Annabel to saying she was a lovely child, a few months my junior. Her parents were old friends of my aunt's, and as stuffy as she. They had rented a villa not far from Hotel Mirana. Bald brown Mr. Lake and fat powdered Mrs. Lake, born Vanessa Van Ness. How I loathed them. At first, Annabel and I talked of peripheral affairs. She kept lifting handfuls of fine sand and letting it pour through her fingers. Our brains were turned the way those of intelligent European pre-adolescents were in our day and set, and I doubt if much individual genius should be assigned to our interest in the plurality of inhabited worlds, competitive tennis, infinity, solipsism, and so on. The softness and fragility of baby animals caused us the same intense pain. She wanted to be a nurse in some famished Asiatic country. I wanted to be a famous spy. All at once, we were madly, clumsily, shamelessly, agonizingly in love with each other, hopelessly, I should add, because that frenzy of mutual possession might have been assuaged only by our actually imbibing and assimilating every particle of each other's soul and flesh. But there we were, unable even to mate as slum children would have so easily found an opportunity to do so. After one wild attempt we made to meet a night in her garden, of which more later, the only privacy we were allowed was to be out of earshot, but not out of sight, on the populous part of the plage. There, on the soft sand, a few feet away from our elders, we would sprawl all morning, in a petrified paroxysm of desire, and take advantage of every blessed quirk in space and time to touch each other. Her hand, half hidden in the sand, would creep toward me, its slender brown fingers sleepwalking nearer and nearer. Then her opalescent knee would start on a long, cautious journey. Sometimes a chance rampart built by younger children granted us sufficient concealment to grace each other's salty lips. These incomplete contacts drove our healthy and inexperienced young bodies to such a state of exasperation that not even the cold blue water under which we still clawed at each other could bring relief. Among some treasures I lost during the wanderings of my adult years, there was a snapshot taken by my aunt, which showed Annabel, her parents, and the staid, elderly, lame gentleman, Dr. Cooper, who that same summer courted my aunt, grouped around a table in a sidewalk cafe. Annabel did not come out well, caught as she was in the act of bending over her chocolat glacé, and her thin, bare shoulders and the parting in her hair were about all that could be identified. As I remember that picture, amid the sunny blur into which her lost loveliness graded. But I, sitting somewhat apart from the rest, came out with a kind of a dramatic conspicuousness, a moody, bell-browed boy in a dark sport shirt and well-tailored white shorts, his legs crossed, sitting in profile, looking away. That photograph was taken on the last day of our fatal summer, and just a few minutes before we made our second and final attempt to thwart fate. Under the flimsiest of pretexts, this was our very last chance and nothing really mattered, we escaped from the cafe to the beach and found a desolate stretch of sand, and there, in the violet shadow of some red rocks forming a kind of cave, had a brief session of avid caresses with somebody's lost pair of sunglasses for only witness. I was on my knees and on the point of possessing my darling when two bearded brothers, the old man of the sea and his brother, came out of the sea with exclamations of ribald encouragement, and 4 months later, she died of typhus in Corfu.